so at this time we consider how we ourselves are in need of God's love and his mercy, which is healing. Lord Jesus, you came to reconcile us to one another and to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you heal the wounds of sin and division. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, intercede for us with your Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting love. Amen. Together let us praise the holy name of God with the Gloria.
Wrath, who will forgive his sins? Remember your last days. Set enmity aside. Remember death and decay, and cease from sin. Think of the commandments. Hate not your neighbor. Remember the Most High's covenant, and overlook faults. The word of the Lord.
Seven times? Jesus answered, I say to you, not 7 times, but 77 times. That is why the kingdom of heaven may be likened to a king who decided to settle accounts with his servants. When he began the accounting, a debtor was brought before him who owed him a large amount. Since he had no way of paying it back, his master ordered him to be sold, along with his wife, his children, and all his property, in payment of the debt. At that, the servant fell down, did him homage, and said, "Be patient with me, and I will pay you back in full." Moved with compassion, the master of that servant let him go and forgave him the loan. When that servant had left, he had found one of his fellow servants who owed him a much smaller amount. He seized him and started to choke him, demanding, "Pay back what you owe." Falling to his knees, his fellow servant begged him, "Be patient with me, and I will pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he had the fellow servant put in prison until he paid back the debt. Now when his fellow servants saw what had happened, they were deeply distressed and disturbed and went to their master and reported the whole affair. His master summoned him and said to him, "You wicked servant, I forgave you your entire debt because you begged me to. Should you not have had pity on your fellow servant as I had pity on you?" Then in anger, his master handed him over to the torturers until he should pay back the whole debt. So will my heavenly Father do to you, unless each of you forgives your brother from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you,
Lord Jesus Christ.
Today we hear about the power of forgiveness and how important forgiveness truly is. Forgiveness is a participation in the reconciliation of God and in humanity. It is also participation in the reconciliation between brother and sister in Christ to one another. And so in other words, when we forgive, we are participating in something that has supernatural origins, that it has roots, it has layers beyond what the eye can see. And so that is a very good thing, it truly is. Forgiveness is powerful. And certainly, yes, we hear from the first readings here today from Sirach as well as today's Gospel reading from Matthew that, yes, there are consequences for not forgiving. It is true. I mean, for instance, in the book of Sirach, we hear about the fate that awaits the person who keeps wrath in their heart. And likewise, too, in today's Gospel reading taken from Matthew's Gospel, we hear about how Jesus does challenge us quite sternly to forgive our brother or sister if we ourselves want to be forgiven. And while that is true, at the same time, it is also good to see the very positive effects of forgiveness and how it helps us. For instance, when we forgive others, we see that we ourselves are limited human beings. We are finite. We have days when, simply put, we're not at our best. It happens to all of us. It definitely happens to me. There are days when we wake up and we may not necessarily feel particularly optimistic about how the day may go. Maybe we don't sleep well. That can happen. Whether it was a fussy child who kept us awake, or as I have had in the past, a cat that decides it's 2 o'clock in the morning. I would much rather be awake and play and eat now compared to letting Dad sleep and be rested for the day. I know now to let the cat sleep in the living room as opposed to letting him sleep on top of the bed. So this way he no longer starts batting at my face at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. In any event, moving along, there are days when we're simply not at our best. We are preoccupied with stressors. Sometimes they are maybe in the long run not the biggest stressors, like our morning commute to work took a little bit too long, things of that nature. But sometimes our stressors are quite real. sometimes it really can be. It's the financial stress of a loan that seems like it'll never be paid off. The financial stress of maintaining a household's income amongst a very uncertain job market. Or there can be other stressors out there too, like someone who is a caregiver for someone who is quite sick, and especially if they have a very debilitating illness that requires a lot of attention. There are people out there carrying really heavy burdens. And so therefore, even though there might be some days when we can say to someone, I'm sorry, I feel bad for snapping at you, I lost my cool, I shouldn't have done that, I was kind of having a bit of a bad day, and in some cases we can kind of laugh about it. But there can be other times when people are deeply and truly burdened, and when it happens, and when they say things or do things that are sins against charity, sins against kindness, those can be opportunities for reconciliation. They can be opportunities for forgiveness, opportunities for healing. In saying the word healing, we can take a look at two of the sacraments in the church. So for instance, we have the sacrament of reconciliation, and we also have the sacrament of the anointing of the sick. Now, for the sacrament of the anointing of the sick, the priest is able to go and to say and to trace holy oil on the person's forehead and their hands, and they're able to say the prayers over them and remind them that the oil is a visible sign. It is a metaphor of Christ being with them. They are remembered by God, they are marked for God, and it is a visible sign of the strengthening that the Lord wants them to receive, that gift of grace. And likewise, too, for the sacrament of reconciliation, that can be a very powerful moment where the person feels like the burden they've been carried with them is no longer quite as heavy. They still may carry scars from the sin. That might still take place, but they don't have to worry about carrying the full burden. So in other words, while there can be times when we feel a sense of responsibility to carry our burdens because it's my responsibility, it's what I have to do, at the same time, we also know that God gives us opportunities, these grace-filled moments, to say, Lord, I trust in you. Lord, I offer you my sins. And then I realize that it is humbling to do so. It is not always the easiest to go to a priest and ask for forgiveness. But when I do that, it also allows me to rely not only on what I can do, not only what I can forgive and be forgiven on my own, but rather to make myself available to receive the supernatural graces that can come only through these sacraments. With the sacrament of reconciliation, there have been certainly times over the course of my 10 years of the priesthood where those approaching the sacrament will come with different sins, in different layers of sins, different serious levels of sin. It is almost always very joyful, almost always in some ways lighthearted when young children go to confession for the first time. I like to joke with them if they're a little bit nervous, like, okay, we can do an examination of conscience, like, all right, have you robbed any banks recently? Well, chances are most second graders haven't robbed too many banks. Okay, have you impersonated someone else's identity online? Well, again, they haven't done that either. And then we're able to go to the sins that might be much more relatable to them. You know, things like maybe not getting along with their brothers or sisters, maybe not getting along with their parents, things like that, not being respectful, things of that nature. However, for those who have lived longer than 7 or 8 years, they may find themselves in need of God's forgiveness. I remember last year having the privilege of being able to go and hear confessions at a Project Rachel retreat in Altamont, being able to listen to the confessions of those who The participants were there because they wanted to be healed after having had abortive procedures done years ago. And even though the procedures were not done necessarily within a very recent timeline, they still carried that sin with them. They still carried the gravity and magnitude of that offense against life. And so it truly was a privilege, it really was, to listen to them pour their hearts out and to be able to do that and just be present. It was certainly for me a humble moment. And so for priests, I think they often do find that the sacrament of reconciliation is one that it challenges us, it allows us to be conduits of God's grace. And even though there can be the temptation to feel a sense of, well, maybe this is a teaching moment, and to be a little too judgmental, it's most importantly what it is it's an opportunity, again, to be a conduit of God's love, of God's forgiveness, and to not put ourselves in the judgment seat, even if it might be a little tempting to do that. Ultimately, the priest realizes he's called to be an agent of forgiveness. Our readings from the Sacred Scripture remind us, again, of how important forgiveness is, and we are also reminded of the balanced nature of this forgiveness. Now, when we look at today's Gospel reading, taken from Matthew's Gospel, here, it makes sense when you do some research as far as why Peter might have thought seven times in forgiveness would make sense. It's because the tradition that Peter grew up with, according to biblical scholars like Diane Bergant, like Richard Fragomini and others, they would say that Peter would have understood that their rabbis would have explained that forgiving someone three times was sufficient. So from Peter's perspective, seven was actually quite generous. Seven is also a biblical number. It is a whole number. So think of the 7 days, 6 days of creation, and then the seventh God rested. So it makes sense why Peter picked the number. It wasn't arbitrary. It wasn't like he said, how many times do I need to forgive? Four, five, eight, and what's seven? Seven was actually quite intentional. But Jesus here reminds us that not seven times, but 77 times, and even then he's making a point. It doesn't mean that we go around with our sketch pad and say, well, okay, it's the 45th time I've forgiven you, or strain equals 77, better watch yourself. It doesn't mean that. What it means instead is God's love and God's forgiveness is infinite, and so should ours. Now, that being said, forgiveness is not necessarily always the same as forgiving, because we don't want forgiveness to turn into an opportunity for us to unnecessarily put ourselves in harm's way, or to unnecessarily make of ourselves someone that other people can walk all over or take advantage of, particularly when it comes to abuse. And so, for instance, when there are cases out there of people who have suffered domestic abuse or have suffered true abuse from people who may be part of their community, what forgiveness allows a person to do is it allows them to go from being a victim to a survivor, and allows them to grow and say, this is something I've overcome with the grace of God, and now I'm stronger. But at the same time, they wouldn't want to automatically put themselves back in the situation where the abuse happened. That's where forgiveness and forgetting are not necessarily the same. And so the person who has suffered great abuse, they should never feel compelled to say, well, it's okay for me to be treated this way, to be walked over, because God tells me to forgive. And that would not be the case. Because we do recognize that we have a sense of dignity and a sense of responsibility of looking out for ourselves. So in any event, let us be as mindful as we can be of forgiving. And again, keep in mind that in the long run, like the servant who demanded payment from this other servant, all ultimately, the depths that we owe to each other, if we think about them, they pale in comparison to the debts that humanity as a whole owes God. And chances are, if we're being honest, we might say, you know what? If I really consider the sins I've committed in the past, in a way, it is almost like taking what God has given me and using it against Him. Maybe not always intentionally, maybe not always, but in the end, it can seem like that occasionally. And because of that, and because that God forgives me, even if I use my God-given sins against Him, if I trust that God forgives me for those sins, then may I in turn be as forgiving as it can be to someone who can never hurt me the way that humans can hurt God. And so we pray for this to be a more forgiving world. We pray that we may be able to extend mercy to each other, because God gives us so many opportunities to be merciful. God gives us so many opportunities to receive His mercy, and may we wish to extend that mercy and forgiveness to others. God bless you.
And together, let's profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, and the Father before all ages. From God, life and blood, true God from true God, yes, and true the Father, and all things are made for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, became man. For our sake, He was crucified by Pontius Pilate, He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who was spoken to the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And so at this time, let us present these needs before the Lord. Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
Amen.
brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your hands, the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Look with favor in our supplications, O Lord, and in your kindness, accept these, your servant's offerings, that what each has offered to the honor of your name may serve the salvation of all, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gathered them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, may the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit might, to the praise of your manifold wisdom, be manifest as the Church. And so, in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church in recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death wilt reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles, the glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession and presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Edward, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you, and your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Turn your heart of brothers and sisters into all who are pleasing to you, at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of their glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom we bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all the glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. May the working of this heavenly gift, O Lord, we pray, take possession of our minds and bodies so that its effects, not our own desires, may always prevail in us through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Again, thank you for joining us today for this liturgy. Certainly wish all of you a very blessed rest of the day today. Now, because this weekend is Grandparents' Weekend, Grandparents' Day is Sunday, I should say, I would like to invite all the grandparents who are tuning in, especially, to please bow your heads for a special blessing. All-powerful and ever-living God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we thank you and praise you for giving the members of our community long years lived in faith and in doing good. Grant that they may have the loving support of their friends and relatives, including grandchildren, those biological grandchildren, and those grandchildren through adoption, and also spiritual grandchildren. that in good health they may be cheerful, and in poor health not lose hope. Sustained by the help of your blessing, let them spend their time giving praise to your name. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks
be to God. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Your defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And to the Prince of the Heavenly Host, for the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and the other evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking to ruin our souls. Amen. This is from our column. This is from a column called Bulletin Loopers. Please sign up to attend the Prayer and Fasting Conference. The cost of attending includes meals.